to me in life, you know, I think the way I play the game of basketball, I don't play for the effect, I play for the result.
I play for to have that one moment out there where I just take over the game and I know I got control.
In this league long by being timid or intimidated by the people you compete against.
Wilkins. It's all about having supreme confidence, and not many guys have it.
When I played the game, my primary asset for my team was my ability to create things.
If you're not on the court playing, you figure 48 hard minutes, then you're coming up.
What really get me psyched up is a dunk. That, you know, to me, you know, that can get me psyched up, get me going.
My philosophy every night, no player shall ever outwork Bernard.
Bernard King over Harper. Gets the rebound, puts it back up, gets it again.
Sports Illustrated presents an NBA entertainment production. Force and Finesse. The fabulous forwards of the NBA. It was 1946. The devastating war had ended. And Americans just wanted to have fun again as an entire nation sought new forms of entertainment. And in the NBA's inaugural season, Jumpin' Joe Fulks became the game's first prolific scorer.
He had such a variety of shots, off balance, one hand, jump shot, everything like that. People would come to see him because they didn't know what he was going to do next.
Next to make an impact was George the Birdman Yardley, a forward with the Pistons and the Nationals, who made basketball history as the first man to score 2,000 points in one season. Although not as distinguished in the record books for individual achievement, Jim Pollard brought his all-court skills to the Minneapolis Lakers and helped forge the game's first dynasty. Joining folks in Philadelphia was Paul Arizin, the game's premier jump shooter.
Paul was one of those very few players who could hang in the air. He was probably the first who would jump up, you know, and if I were playing him, I'd go up with him and then I'd come down and Paul would still be in the air. He was able to hang and had a great jump shot.
The New York Knickerbockers featured a forward tandem of their own in former Harlem Globetrotter Sweetwater Clifton, who was one of the first players to break the color barrier and to dazzle the fans. And Iron Man Harry Gallatin, who established a Knick record for consecutive games played.
One of the things that God gave me that I still have today is some just strength and stamina. I've been able to call upon that all my life, and I also have a tremendous desire to be the best.
As did Syracuse's Dolph Shays, who endlessly honed his shooting touch.
I was one of these gym rats who just kept working and working and working, and I would copy what some other great two-hand set shooters did in the way they shot the ball. And I guess I became a very good shooter because I shot thousands of shots.
When it came to shooting, Tom Heinsohn was not known for his bashfulness.
My job was to shoot the ball. I was a scorer. I wasn't really a great shooter per se, but I could get hot for 10 in a row and from all different angles and drive the other team nuts.
Bob Pettit seemed to stay hot for an entire decade, and desire was at the crux of his success.
I was playing against the best basketball players in the world, and I wanted to play well. And I wanted to play the best of everybody. And I was determined that I was going to do well. And, you know, and I worked and played as hard as I could play.
And so, the 11-time All-Star would be the standard bearer of this early era, an era of fabulous forwards in the NBA. This honor roll would not be complete without one Maurice Stokes, a player whose career was tragically cut short by a paralyzing injury. But for the precious years that he did grace the hardwood floor, it was to bear witness to pure mastery of the sport.
Maurice, had he been able to continue his career, would have been the dominant player in professional basketball history. If you think about a fella 6'7", playing at about 275, that could dribble the length of the floor, play guard, forward, take it in the pivot, do whatever had to be done on the basketball floor, there aren't too many of those people that have ever played the game.
He was today's player in the 50s. He had everything, and he loved the game. You know, whenever he came to play, he was smiling, he was happy, he was playing the game of his life, and he loved it.
Perhaps what this special person left us was a vision of the future.
Maurice Stokes, in my opinion, was a forerunner of Magic Johnson. I would say if his career wasn't cut short, undoubtedly he'd be a Hall of Famer and also would have been one of the greats in NBA history. He was that good, he really was.
In the decade of the 60s, the curtain would rise for one of basketball's greatest showmen, one of the first to bring flair to the forward position. His creative genius on the court electrified the audience. But ironically, though one of the game's most flamboyant players, he was a man of modest aspirations.
I never anticipated a career in professional basketball because I never saw my first professional basketball game until my junior year in college. And when I first joined the Minneapolis Lakers, I wasn't so sure that I would be on the starting team, let alone playing any. And I was just excited about that.
Not only did Elgin start, but with his unique gift for the spectacular, he would come to redefine the game. Using his amazing ability to defy gravity, he would launch an unprecedented aerial assault. Pioneering new forms of artistry, Elgin would prove to be a forerunner of the modern game.
It's a natural thing. It's a gift from God. It's nothing that you can work on and try to develop. The only thing you can do is try to create different shots from different positions. Once you get in the air, that's nothing you work on. It's just something that comes naturally. You either have it or you don't.
Elgin was the first one that I remember to, you know, go up for the jump shot and hang up there for 15 seconds, have some lunch and a cup of coffee, and, you know, the defenders would all be back on the ground, and he'd finally decide to shoot the thing. His hang time was incredible. Elgin was that spectacular where he literally became the first guy that couldn't be stopped.
I just thought that he was the greatest thing since sliced bread. Well, I think Elgin Baylor was a player who was certainly ahead of his time in regards to forward play. He played the game back in those days the way Julius Erving came into the league and played the games. Not necessarily with as much flair as Julius had, but certainly with a great deal more than any other player in the league had.
There aren't too many different things you can do out there on the basketball floor. So naturally, I guess some of the things some of the players are doing, it's probably some of the things that I've done before.
Elgin's groundbreaking style would lay the foundation for a legion of show-stopping forwards to come. In the 70s, this new generation would flourish. There was the unstoppable Rick Barry, whose well-equipped arsenal made him a creative force that was difficult to contend with.
My primary asset for my team was my ability to create things, to either score a basket, get a good shot, or hit an open man with a pass. And I always played the game that way, and I always looked to create shots for myself when I had the ball in my hands. And I would take the shot, provided that I did not have a teammate in a better position.
In amassing over 27,000 career points, Elvin Hayes often found himself in the right position to bury his fabled turnaround jumper.
God had blessed me with a talent and an ability to go out and to work and to try to play to the best of my ability. And I relied on that. And when it all was said and done, it had to be done out there in that square. And that's where I always played.
Rudy Tomjanovich, an all-purpose forward whose soft touch and powerful play confounded all who would defend him. While speedy swingman Lou Hudson was a terror in the open floor and a dead-eye marksman in the half-court game. And Chet Walker utilized size and speed to make his mark. In 1974, rookie Keith Wilkes helped bring a title to the Warriors and proved that an undersized forward can withstand the physical rigors of the NBA.
There were a lot of questions about my size. Would I be able to withstand the rigorous schedule and traveling? Or would I hold up physically? And I had some doubts myself. So I was kind of pumped up that first year. I wanted to prove some people wrong and show some people I could play, and more importantly, show myself.
There were also initial questions about one-time guard Bill Bradley. But after finding his niche in the front court, he flourished as the cornerstone of the Knicks team philosophy.
I always tried to be a player who was sensitive to my other teammates, to their strengths and to their weaknesses. And I tried to do things that would, in some senses, make them look good, but in the process, clearly make the team win.
Another winning formula, the sweet jumper of Bobby Dandridge, which brought championships to Milwaukee and Washington. And Spencer Haywood, the dominating ABA superstar who longed to go head-to-head with the best the NBA had to offer.
I had no other feats to defend there. I mean, I was Rookie of the Year, Most Valuable Player, Leading Scorer, Leading Rebounder, Most Valuable Player in the All-Star Game. So what was left? The NBA, of course. And then I decided that, look, I got to play with the big boys.
Having made the transition, Haywood joined an elite class of high-scoring forwards of the 70s, a group as diverse as they were talented. But there were others like Dave DeBuscher and Gus Johnson, whose individual greatness was underscored by their classic confrontations. He was the vibrant heart of the New York Knicks. And he was the indomitable soul of the Baltimore Bullets. Their personal battles raged, and no one would be taken prisoner.
We played each other head-on as hard as you can play two guys, and I don't think I've come out of game sore than the ones I've played against Gus Johnson.
And all eyes were drawn to this titanic struggle between the game's most physical forwards. Though their clashes are a thing of the past, Gus Johnson and Dave DeBuscher are vividly remembered for their epic battle. The schoolyards of New York, where style is as important as substance. And reputations are earned anew with every confrontation. From this treacherous proving ground would emerge one of basketball's greatest playground legends, Connie Hawkins. Beginning his professional career with the Globetrotters and then moving on to the ABA, Hawkins would remain true to his basketball beginnings.
In the playgrounds where I came from, most of the time it was an expression of your attitude and your lifestyle. And most of the time when you played out there, it was always dog eat dog, and you had to fight for your life. And if a guy did a dunk on you, you tried to do a 360 or some type of, whatever he did to you, you try and do something to him twice as better as he tried to do it to you.
Joining the NBA at age 27, he was an immediate all-star. Matching his acrobatic skills against the world's best players, he would prove that his playground pedigree was enough to make him a superstar at any level.
I was constantly playing in the summer leagues with guys that have always played in the NBA. I was playing against Willis Reed and Wilt Chamberlain and these guys all year long. So I was constantly playing against the best ball players that the NBA had to offer anyway. So I was, when I came, I was ready to play.
He was the first that I had ever seen with the huge hands that could glide and dunk and stuff all kind of different ways. Connie was the ultimate finesse and slithery kind of body and moves, you know. He used to tantalize you. He'd come at you like this with one hand and you'd reach for it and he could take it into the other hand and throw it up some kind of way because he had awesome paws.
I found out that if I can control the ball with one hand and kind of push guys with my other hand, I was more effective, and that's how I gradually developed the style, and it was something that just instinctively happened.
With his dizzying array of moves, Hawkins added a new dimension to front court artistry, bringing a fluid grace to his craft and a philosophical approach to the game.
I found out one thing, this is for sure. I found out that the older I get, the better I played when I was younger.
These next gentlemen could make you feel old in a hurry. They are the game's first enforcers, and none are more renowned than Maurice Lucas. Bill Bridges held his ground against those who dared venture into his domain. And the often overpowering Paul Silas wielded the strength of two men. Around the league, things got pretty rough in the paint. Amid the clash of banging bodies, a classic confrontation of basketball immortals Larry Bird and Julius Erving would unfold.
From the University of Massachusetts, number 6, Julius the Doctor Erving!
Indiana State, 6'9", number 33, Larry Bird.
You can sometimes sense and see and feel that he's coming at you and he's trying to prove something. And of course you react to that. I mean, you don't back down to that challenge.
During two epic seven-game playoff battles in the early 80s, a young Larry Bird issued his challenge to the league's preeminent star.
The one thing about Dr. J is that he was a superstar, and I was coming to the league at a young age, and every night that we played, it was always built up me and him, and we had some great battles.
He's got a crack at it. Three-pointer.
In the years to follow, the Boston Celtics and the Philadelphia 76ers would engage in a bitter struggle for conference supremacy, while their two living legends staged a mythic rivalry for the ages. They are the state of the art in front court performance. High-tech visions of the future. They are built for power and grace. They are faster, stronger, better. And they refuse to be stopped. forwards of the 90s, Karl Malone and Charles Barkley, are a preview of the new wave in NBA athleticism.
Whoops. The sucker play by Barkley. Does it work?
Yes.
The development of these devastating weapons was painstaking.
I was never in a situation where I was just like the most talented guy around. Maybe I was 5'10 and I weighed 220, so I wasn't like the fastest guy in the world. So it was just God rid of best in a lot later, you know, but it made me a better person not being that good, that quick. It made me work that much harder.
Now Charles Barkley will outwork you and outplay you. He is a force of one who dominates at will and takes over when it counts.
I always want the ball in a tough situation because I feel like nothing personal against the guys I'm playing with, but I have more confidence in myself than I do anybody else I'm playing with. And I would rather have that responsibility because I have that kind of confidence. You have to have that kind of confidence to be successful.
Karl Malone, too, does not lack for confidence. An incomparable physical specimen, his intensity matches his talent. His philosophy is simple, survival of the fittest, and he is a relentless opponent who asks no mercy and gives no quarter.
I like to see a little blood every now and then. You know what I'm saying? Make me think I'm working. You know, make me think I'm earning my money. That's what men are made. You know what I'm saying? Men are made when they thump their toe and they gotta sit out and they gotta go get a stitch and things like that.
From Malone, the bottom line is results, and his are spectacular. He is an unyielding competitor who will accept nothing but victory.
I take winning series. Sure, you know, it's gonna be a lot of legends out there in years to come. But when I go out, when I suit up and go out there to play, I might have friends on the other side, but hey, I'm going out to win.
These are forwards for a new age, so draw your battle plans with care. For these one-man wrecking crews will lead their assaults boldly into the future.
Here's what we want. Listen, get in there. Jumper, we want tight on this guy, we want a guy here and a guy here.
The NBA coach, a field general who marshals his troops nightly, and there are few who are as vital to team strategy as the hired gun known as the sixth man. They perform with stunning efficiency, and their growing importance is emblematic of an evolutionizing game. Virtuoso performer John Havlicek, regarded as basketball's most memorable sixth man. Havlicek was the all-purpose player on 8 championship teams.
My theory was that when I make my first substitution, I am not having a lesser productive team in there, but I'm improving my team by putting in a player of more ability.
The position employed his versatile talents, and Hondo embraced the opportunity.
I looked at it as an opportunity to make a mark in the league. And I set out to become the best sixth man because it was a significant role.
A Celtic legend had been born, and Havlicek continued to astound with his unsurpassed flair for the dramatic.
Pass goes to Havlicek. He's coming around to the left. The shot is good. The shot is good, and that's it.
There's a lot of teams using that concept today, but it was done here and it helped us win championships.
On a play, he gets it out deep and Havlicek steals it over his man Jones. Havlicek stole the ball. It's all over. It's all over.
Another great sixth man, Philadelphia's unconventional Billy Cunningham.
My responsibility was to come in most cases give a spark offensively for the ball club.
Cunningham quickly gained a reputation for his many shots that defied description. After 9 years as a player, he joined the coaching ranks and served as mentor to super sub Bobby Jones.
Bobby!
Jones was a prominent specialist of a different kind.
He's always one to try and direct attention away from himself and towards a teammate or towards the coach or towards someone else, when, in my mind, Bobby is as much a prime-time player as anybody who has really played this game.
The consensus in Boston was clear. For the Celtics had a sixth man of their own to be reckoned with.
Sometimes you can stay in the game really well on the bench. You can get in the game, you're watching the flow of the game. So when you get involved physically, you're there, you're ready to go.
Once inserted, McHale dominated at both ends of the court.
McHale storming it. And Gerard Burke blocked by McHale.
Unlike McHale, the sixth men of today possess very distinct attributes. All of them are potent. There is the torrid shooting of Eddie Johnson, the explosive play of Thurl Bailey, and the reckless abandon of Dennis Rodman.
Michael Jordan with Pippen.
I just get so happy when I come off the bench because I just want to do things that other players don't do.
There is another group of men who thrive on doing what other players don't. Or can't. Or dare not. They are the blue-collar workers. They are the keepers of the peace. They are the enforcers, and from first to last, they are not to be trifled with.
The enforcer's role is the guy who's like the backbone of the team. When push comes to shove, he's there in the middle of the fights. He's Mr. Macho, you know, he walks around and everyone knows that, hey, you can't play around with this guy because, you know, he'll do whatever it takes to get the job done.
Ah! Ooh, Danny Green drilled him.
Hold him, no shot!
Oh, here we go.
I got you!
For these men, every game is a battle to be waged. The directives are clear. Beneath the backboard, they fight endlessly for survival, and the sounds of colliding bodies echo the ferocity of their struggle. But they are more than just muscle-bound bangers. They are multi-talented warriors, always ready to answer the call.
Albert King, Barkley for three! Oh, no!
Their game begins with strength. Self-made men, they are players who are willing to endure pain to give their team the edge that only they can provide.
I'd go up and I'd bang a guy first play of the game. And I'd just find out if he's ready to play or if he's not.
I think in my neighborhood, it was a physical thing. I think only the strong survive. I had guys on the sideline saying, get tough, X, get tough. Don't let him push you.
This is a philosophy that links these players together.
I didn't like other people on other teams because I had to play against them. I didn't have any friends. Nobody liked me. I ain't like them. So that's the kind of edge I had. So if I knock the hell out of you, I don't have to deal with you the rest of the night.
But when they meet, reputations are often on the line.
I don't let no one just dog me, you know, do this, push me, shove me, you know. I really held my ground inside against anyone.
And with the game at stake, no holds are barred.
I'd do anything for us to win, whatever it take. Not to play dirty or try to hurt another guy's career, but I just go out and get the job done.
Intimidation is a lot of it, and I try to use an enforcer-type attitude to give me that edge.
We're out there to play basketball. That's messing with their subconscious mind because they're looking around saying, well, I may get hit on this play.
So keep your eyes open and don't cross the line, because waiting on the other side are the enforcers. In these capable hands, the torch of basketball artistry would be passed.
When I first came into professional basketball, I came into the ABA, and there was talk about me being compared to Connie Hawkins, Elgin Baylor. Then they started saying, well, you know, this guy is has his own style. And since I had such a catchy nickname, they just said, well, you're Dr. J, we don't compare you to anybody.
For the doctor, making a house call often meant bringing the house down.
Pass is deflected, going to be stolen, I think, by the doctor. Yes, he's got it. Here he comes. Ray rocked the baby to sleep and slam dunk.
Like all doctors, his preparation was meticulous. His concentration intense. The only tool of his trade was a basketball. And with it, he turned routine procedures into history-making operations.
I don't play for the effect, I play for the result.
They were never short of breathtaking. The good doctor never disappointed his clientele. A tireless practitioner, he thrived in pressure situations.
Irving to Cheeks, back to Irving, sent it.
The affair he has with this game of basketball is phenomenal. Just every night coaching him, I'd look over to Matty Gukas or Chuck Daly and say, where did he get this move?
Irving first began collecting rave reviews in the ABA, where his compelling play brought a new league to prominence.
It does something in here. You know, you know that you have to take on this challenge.
His next challenge would be to bring his heralded act to the NBA. He would do so in magnificent fashion, leading his new team, the Philadelphia 76ers, to the NBA Finals in his first year. He injected the league with his distinctive brand of excitement.
He had that flair about him. He had that extraordinary ability to create excitement. And that's what really, I think, made him a step above so many other players.
And perhaps one play best captured the essence of his impact.
I just couldn't believe it. And everybody just looked at each other like, what should we do? I mean, should we take the ball out or should we ask him to do it again?
But encores can't last forever.
You come to realize at some point in time that the show will go on without you, as well as it went on with you.
Though it does go on, it will always bear the mark of perhaps its most spellbinding artist.
This is a journey into sound.
A forward journey is often a perilous one. And no matter how skilled, not even the most imposing superstar can escape its bruising tribulations. Best at what they do, and they have become known as the specialists.
Out!
These are the forwards of the 80s.
They've dropped off now.
Highly skilled professionals whose finely tuned talents make them prime movers in their fields of expertise.
So happened all throughout my career, high school, college, pros, even though I've had players on my team 5-6 inches taller than me, the coach always wanted me there.
Against Charles Jones. Here's Danley. AD.
I think I have perhaps a little bit more city basketball in me than perhaps some of the other West Coast players. I played a lot in the inner city.
Jump shot blocked by the KO and it comes down with the ball.
If you don't learn something from every basketball game you play and every minute you're on the court, you're not progressing the way you should. I learn something every time I play.
Most of the things that happen with me offensively happens naturally, or it's very spontaneous.
When you get into that flow, you want the ball, you gotta have the ball. You just know that you can score.
Bernard King again.
What I derive out of this game in terms of fun and ambition is winning. Number one, and that's utmost in my mind.
6 seconds to go in the overtime. Bernard King for three. Got it. With 2 seconds to go.
Just a blue-collar worker that goes out every night to get the job done, and you can count on me when it chips it down.
Strong move by Buck Williams, and they jump it up.
think that's my best game of transition game.
Crooks and back and it's into the waiting arms of Atlanta's Leon Woods, to Wilkins, who's alone for his Melo.
In the half court, I like the isolation plays, which we run a lot.
Basketball's earliest beginnings, its followers have longed to grasp and strained to see the image of the perfect player. But it would be in the decade of the 80s that his evolution would become complete. In the person of Larry Bird, celebration has followed him at every turn. From humble French Lick, Indiana, to the tradition-rich Boston Garden, he has astounded all who have been privileged to watch him.
He's going to go one-on-one. Oh, my goodness! How did he do that?
Even fellow players cannot help to be amazed.
He just gets that feeling where he knows that it's going in, and you just get him the ball and watch him play.
Though he often seems able to do the impossible, his philosophy is simple.
I don't look to play the perfect game, hitting 15 out of 15 shots, making all my free throws and no turnovers, and make the right decisions. I don't play for that, but I play for to have that one moment out there where I just take over the game and I know I got control.
It is such moments from which the legend of Larry Bird has grown.
2 seconds left. The Bullets by one, aims to Bird, and gets a good shot in the shoulder. Incredible.
Dennis gets it in the Bird. Larry, a runner.
Got it! Ball game's over, Boston wins.
DJ again to make the inbound pass, the double team in Bird. Larry, fake, fall away.
Hits it!
Possessing a seemingly endless supply of miracles, he has written his own chapter of Celtic lore.
Now there's a steal by Bird. Underneath the DJ, lays it in. Right half, 1 second left. What a play by Bird. Bird stole the inbounding pass. Laid it up to DJ. DJ laid it up and in. And Boston has a 1 point lead with 1 second left.
From Bird's first days in the NBA, there was a majesty to his play that invited comparisons to the greatest who have ever played his position.
When I first come in the league, they sort of compare me to Havlicek, but they don't anymore, and it's sort of disappointing because I loved the way he played.
Like Havlicek, Bird plays the game in its purest form.
He's not an overpowering player, but he hustles a great deal. He plays both ends of the floor, and I think that he plays with his head a great deal, too.
More than anything else, it is his uncanny feel for the game that is the key to his greatness. The basketball court is his natural habitat. It is there that his irrepressible spirit soars free and inspires all who share it with them.
We both make each other play our best game. You know, and that's the best thing about this Bird-Johnson rivalry.
He is the prototype for his position, and though adept at every facet of the game, he is never content, rising to greater heights to meet each new challenge.
He can just be satisfied with what he has, what he's accomplished. Hey, I'm at the top, and that's it. And I don't have to work hard anymore. That's not Larry.
He is the symbol of all that is noble in his sport. Of determination, of pride, and of loyalty.
I'm so proud to be a part of the Celtic tradition and the organization that, you know, sometimes it might seem that way, but I don't think that I'll ever, ever give up that Celtic uniform.